I've taken from the streets of the Bronx to this moment on Hollywood Boulevard. And this all feels, I don't know, kind of surreal. I just wanted to be good at what I did. I wanted to be a great actress. I wanted to be a great singer. I wanted to be a great performer to share the joy of entertaining you.
This is Hollywood, with the mecca of entertainment around the world. It all starts right here. This is what it all comes down to. It all comes down to your family and working hard to love and protect and do everything that you can to make your family and the ones you love, their lives better.
It's thrilling to have Anna May Wong, the first Asian American actress, as my neighbor. We could actually start our own little Chinatown right here.
I think about what a star is, and I think about a star being liked for so many people. A star you can always see, even in darkness. So my hope is that anyone in this town whose dreams may be on life support, I want you to walk past this star in particular and know that I've been there. This one in particular is for the underdogs.
An incredible day. I'm trying to soak it all in. Here's the thing about these Hollywood stars. They're permanent. What is a legacy? It's planting seeds in a garden you never get to see. Well, we get to see this star every day on the corner of Hollywood and Argyle.
Lo único que les puedo decir es que siempre recuerden que trabajando mucho, sin descansar y respetándose uno mismo y respetando a los demás, se pueden lograr cosas que uno nunca se soñó. Gracias a todos mis fans por estar aquí y un beso a Colombia y a todos los colombianos que están aquí. Gracias por venir.
I feel like a lot of people probably only ever thought I'd make it to the Walk of Shame, but here I am. Today for me is a celebration of something that my dad taught me. And that is, to thine own self be true. And if you walk along this boulevard and you look at these names, there is a power that lies in that. There's a power in believing in yourself.
Hello, Hollywood! And hello to fans watching around the world on our live stream presented by our media partner, Variety. Today, Hollywood honors Peter Roth with the 2,705th star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. Before we invite him up on stage, first let me tell you a little bit about your honoree. And I hope you're all comfortable, because this man's career is epic. Peter Roth is one of the most iconic television executives of our generation. He has greenlit many of our favorite TV shows. Peter is a native of Larchmont, New York, and graduated from Tufts University, which is outside of Boston, where I'm from. He began his career in 1975 as an assistant at Filmsways Television. In 1976, he became manager of children's programs at ABC and went on to spend the next decade at the network. At ABC, he rose the ranks to become vice president of current primetime series, overseeing such classic shows as Happy Days, Laverne and Shirley, Moonlighting, and Dynasty, and I know many of us grew up watching those. He went on to become president of Stephen J. Cannell Productions, which is located right here in Hollywood, right there down the street, where he was involved in the creation of 21 Jump Street and The Commish. In fact, Stephen Starr is very close to this location, right in front of the Roosevelt Hotel. In 1992, Peter moved to 20th Century Television, where he oversaw the development of The X-Files, Picket Fences, Buffy the Vampire Slayer, and King of the Hill. In 1996, he moved to Fox, becoming president of Fox Entertainment, where he was responsible for the development of the Emmy Award-winning show Ally McBeal, That 70s Show, and Family Guy. And finally, in 1999, Peter joined Warner Brothers Television, where he became the chairman of the Warner Brothers Television Group. While leading Warner Brothers Television, Peter was responsible for signing exclusive overall deals with many creators, including J.J. Abrams, Mindy Kaling, Michael Patrick King, Bill Lawrence, Bryan Cranston, Robert Zemeckis, and several who are here with us today, Chuck Lorre, woo! Greg Berlanti, and Ava DuVernay. I hope you're comfortable, because these lists are quite long. During his tenure at Warner Brothers, 32 scripted primetime series reached the 100-episode milestone, including The Big Bang Theory, Supernatural, Two and a Half Men, The West Wing, Gilmore Girls, Gossip Girl, Mike and Molly, Smallville, Shameless, Pretty Little Liars, One Tree Hill, The Vampire Diaries, and many, many others. No, I'm not going to list all 32. Peter has not only been a leader in the entertainment industry, he has also been passionately involved with many charities, including Autism Speaks, Children's Hospital of Los Angeles, and the Saban Community Clinic. Please help me welcome to the stage Peter Roth. But before we hear from Peter, we have three guest speakers who would like to say a few words about our honoree. Our first speaker is a prolific, award-winning television writer and producer, having created, executive produced, or written more than 1,000 episodes of television spanning the past three decades, including Two and a Half Men, The Big Bang Theory, Mike and Molly, Sybil, Mom, Dharma and Greg, Grace Under Fire, The Kominsky Method, and Roseanne. Currently, he is the executive producer of Young Sheldon, Bob Hart's Abishola, Be Positive, and United States of Al. Please welcome to the stage Walk of Famer Chuck Lorre.
What an honor. Thank you very much. As you can see, we have some people protesting the abrupt cancellation of Mom across the street. So I'm right there with you guys. Very disappointed. Show is doing great. All right, let it go. It sounds like the inside of my head on any given day. It's really, really quite appropriate. All right. It's such an honor to be here to celebrate Peter's career, which, to be honest, without Peter, I'm playing bar mitzvahs in Tarzana. I'm done. There is nothing. You've been such a big part of my life, both professionally and personally. I'm so grateful to be here to celebrate this with you. Just a few things I wanted to say before I fell a lot. You need to understand that the underlying emotion that pervades all of show business is fear. Fear of being fired, fear of being canceled, fear of having to send your kids to public school. Fear. It's pervasive. Actors, writers, directors, we're all running scared. Peter, while I've seen him exhibit some flop sweats at table reads and shoot nights, comes from a different place entirely, which is what makes him so special. Peter comes from love. First and foremost, the love for his family, Andrea, Brian, Erica, grandkids now, Sarah. Love for television, the making of television, the people who make television. There is, you guys who've been on the firing line know what I'm talking about. There's no more supportive, more generous, more loving man to work for than Peter Roth. And I can't tell you how many times I've looked over to see if Peter was laughing at a table read or a run through or a shoot night, because if he's laughing, we're okay. And he's willing to laugh. He's willing to be vulnerable and to be human. And that's not necessarily a given with network and television executives. You know, stoicism is more the calling card. But Peter let his humanity come through, and it was an enormous support. And they read off my resume, but they left a few things out. Dabrowski and Milinkovitch. Two Families, The Tyler Perry Show, Slightly Damaged People, Nathan's Choice, Venus on the Hard Drive, It's Good to Be King, Dirty Girls, Feeding the Monsters, Three Cinderellas, and the first blown pilot for The Big Bang Theory. Those are all the failures. So many of them were so bad they never got to television. And he didn't give up on me. He never gave up. I mean, he may have regretted at times, but he never gave up. And for that, I'm eternally grateful. I miss you. All right, and with this, I will close. I wrote a poem for Peter. Some of you might have seen it, but I've always was hoping someday I'd get to read it. A little performance art. It's entitled Peter in the Hug, with apologies to Casey at the bat. The smile was gone from Peter's lip. A tear rolled down his cheek. The COVID kept him distant, week after lonely week. So many years he cheered us on, our happy hugging hero. Looking back, it now seems clear Peter was patient zero. But long before the virus raged, before the age of SVOD, a deal was struck to reel in Chuck and pray he pleased the less God. A year went by, then two, then three. Peter's bet seemed a dead end. Until one day, CBS in May picked up 2 and a Half Men. With syndication, vindication, and an executive's nirvana, Peter was eating dinner now by the front window at Toscana. A Chardonnay, Mr. Roth? Or how about a nice Chianti? Something to go with the golden eggs laid by Greg Berlanti. Retirement's not an option for men such as he. Peter's thinking showbiz while he's sitting down to pee. He survived the crash of AOL, the CEOs from Christmas past. He made himself a new deal when Sarah Connor fell on her ass. But can he give us the next Netflix? And we'd happily settle for half. That's the question from the Gentiles at American Telephone and Telegraph. Oh, somewhere cop shows reign supreme and sitcoms are so witty. But there is no joy in Burbank. Losing Peter feels pretty shitty. Love you. Congratulations.
Thank you. Before we introduce our next speaker, we have a few VIPs in the audience who are here today supporting Peter. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give a round of applause for actress Mayim Bialik. Chairman of Warner Brothers Television Group, Channing Dungey. And former chairman and CEO of Warner Brothers, Barry Meyer. Finally, I'd like to give a shout out to Captain Brent McGuire and the LAPD. Thank you for being here to support Hollywood and keeping some folks at bay today. We really have the LAPD to thank for that. Our next speaker is an Oscar nominee, Emmy, BAFTA, and PBD award winner, as well as writer, director, producer, and film distributor. Her feature directorial work includes the Oscar-winning civil rights drama Selma, the Oscar-nominated social justice documentary 13th, and the Disney adventure A Wrinkle in Time, which made her the highest-grossing black female director in American box office history. Her other works include When They See Us, Colin in Black and White, Home Sweet Home, Queen Sugar, Cherish the Day, Naomi, and many others. She amplifies the work of black artists, people of color, and women through Array, her narrative change collective. Please welcome Ava DuVernay to the stage.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm not funny, so it's really challenging to go after Peter Lorre. I'm going to do the best I can and just speak from the heart. Excuse me, Chuck Lorre, and speak from the different Lorre. The first time I met the legendary Peter Roth was to discuss a partnership with Warner Brothers for my first television series, Queen Sugar. The experience was unlike anything I have ever experienced. Here was a person who was, on paper, the polar opposite of me. But from the moment I met him, I felt an instant connection, a comfort, a trust, and that is who Peter is, a genuine, truly authentic man who has a passion, a deep passion for storytelling and for storytellers, for supporting artists and our vision. The kind of collaborative relationship that Peter and I have is exactly the kind of relationship that, while unlikely on the surface, is possible in this industry. When you work together to bridge differences and find common ground. And he was the one who fostered that so beautifully with me. I had a lot of mistrust, but he reached out his hand to me in really beautiful ways and has continued to do that. 3 years ago, I officially joined the Warner Brothers television family for one reason, this guy. That's it. He was the reason I knew my storytelling would have the opportunity to reach a wider audience. He was the reason I knew my creativity there would be valued and could thrive. And I miss you too, very much. Every step of the way, I felt supported and championed by him personally and the whole team that he put together. even when there were bumps in the road. I don't know how many of you have experienced the joy of receiving a call or an email from Peter Roth. But let me tell you, if you're an artist, it is a thing of wonder. His enthusiasm and attention to detail is unmatched. He's gonna find the thing in your script or in that shot or in the music selection. He's gonna talk to you about it and you're gonna think, no one else loves me like you do, Peter. And you're gonna feel that, and he's gonna make you feel that because it's true. It's unmatched. He reads every script, watches all of these cuts. He shares thoughts in such specific detail, you're thinking, how did you catch that? How did you know? And he does that for dozens and dozens and dozens and dozens of artists at the same time. Hearing Peter would always brighten my day. No one sends an email like him. No one puts pep in your step. And gives you the motivation to keep going, that what you're doing on the page or in that scene connects to something larger and that it matters. And that's why my admiration and genuine awe has soared to new heights in getting to know him more personally. So we moved from making work together to tapping into the things that he cares about that go outside of the work, that goes into the way that we work. I told him about an idea I had to create a database that would connect underrepresented production crew members to people who hire. Before I could even finish explaining the concept, he said, kid, I'm in. I was like, but you don't really know what we're talking about. I'm in. Okay. He had ideas, good ideas, on how to scale it bigger than I had ever dreamed. And he not only began talking to me about it and my team at Array about it and how to actually put it together, but nearly every day, please hear me, every day for months, he made personal calls to his peers so they would join the effort as well. He reached into the heads of studios, his friends, and said, you need to listen to her. Get emotional. Listen to her. What she's saying is important. I knew he used his influence to get people on board. And it wasn't always an immediate yes. He would actually call me and say, I'm making a sixth call. I'm going in, kid, I'm going in. The sixth call to some of these executives. He was so invested in the effort that now the platform exists. It is called Array Crew. It went from an idea in my head to being a full-fledged, proven, real model for inclusion on sets. And every single studio in Hollywood is a partner because of him. All of them. Everyone. Everyone. That's the power of Peter Roth. But that executive power and the power of connection to an artist is not the greatest power he has. One of the greatest things I've observed about Peter that really made me love him from day one was how much he loves his wife. It always struck me as extraordinary that this very busy, powerful man talks about his wife with such reverence and respect and joy all day, Andrea. You should know that. Andrea is the woman next to the man, and his love of her makes so many of us love him even more, because it takes a very special heart to always include your heart as you walk out into the world, and he does that. You are extraordinary. You're a one-of-a-kind soul. And I count myself blessed to know you. To be able to call you my friend is something that I hold very dear and will treasure always. Congratulations on your unmatched career. No one has done this in television and on this very well-deserved honor today. Congratulations. Love you.
I forgot to wear my waterproof mascara today. That was hard at the end. Thank you. Last but not least, this speaker is an award-nominated writer, director, and producer who is the creative force behind some of the most inventive and acclaimed works in film and television. He has been a trailblazer for representation and inclusivity of the LGBTQIA+ community in his work. He is the executive producer and creative force behind the CW Network's Arrowverse, based on DC characters, which launched in 2012, with Arrow and now includes
DC's Legends of Tomorrow, DC's Stargirl, The Flash, Supergirl, and others. He is also executive producer of All American, Kung Fu, Riverdale, The Flight Attendant, and more. Please welcome to the stage, Greg Berlanti.
All right. Thank you, Nicole. I'm very proud to be here celebrating my friend and mentor, Peter Roth, a man who's launched thousands of careers, hundreds of hit TV shows, and a million hugs. A television legend who will no doubt be cited along with names like Paley and Tartikoff as one of the executives in the TV business whose rare talents, vision, and commitment to excellence set a new standard for what the art form could be. I met Peter Roth before he met me. I was a latchkey kid in the 70s, and television was my most available parent. My first TV love was Saturday morning cartoons. From Scooby-Doo to Super Friends, I watched and devoured every minute, certain no one on earth loved these characters and these shows more than I did. How wrong I was. Across the country and the airwaves was a mid-20-something Peter Roth in his first network job as manager, then quickly director of children's programming for ABC. Peter was already so obsessed with his work, he would often wake his amazing and amazingly patient wife, Andrea, to watch the Saturday morning cartoon lineup with him, an act that in any other marriage would end in divorce or justifiable homicide. As certain as I am that many of us wouldn't be where we are today without Peter's support and encouragement, I'm equally certain that none of us would be here today without Andrea's love and support of Peter. It was Andrea who had first said, "What have you got to lose?" just a few years prior when the recently married couple was still living in New York City and her young husband told her he'd been offered his first job in Hollywood for producer Ira Barmack. Peter had impressed Ira by working on a pilot for free. This explains, of course, Peter's point of view on salary negotiations for the rest of his career. So Peter and Andrea packed up their 1975 Oldsmobile and drove across the country. It was a car ride that would take them both further than they could ever dream. That ride had Peter climbing the executive ranks from ABC to Stephen Cannell Productions to Fox, and finally to his historic 22-year run at Warner Brothers. Along that ride, he oversaw and developed a string of TV classics, frankly, too long to list. Equally unparalleled are the TV creators Peter recruited, collaborated with, and sometimes frustrated, and always championed along the way. A list so famous they don't need first names, like Spelling and Cannell, Laurie and Kelly, Abrams, Wells, DuVernay, Lindelof, Nolan. In what I consider to be the most blessed moment of my own career, I first met Peter Roth in person and got to join his showrunner roster in 2001, just a few months after September 11th. I'd written a family drama called Everwood about a recently widowed New York surgeon who moved his kids to a little Colorado town to focus on being a better dad. I knew instantly that Peter loved the pilot script because he proceeded to tell the story of it back to me at dinner with so much passion and vigor, for a moment I forgot I had conceived and written it. And that was my introduction to the brilliant machine that is Peter. Over the next 20 years, like most, I was in awe of and overwhelmed by his now fabled management style. The handwritten notes for every start and wrap of production, the handwritten Christmas cards to everyone in town that I'm convinced he begins writing in June, the lengthy emails at 5 in the morning about a cut of an episode for a sixth-year series he had watched and loved before anyone, the meetings and calls when he didn't like a cut or a script, where Peter would declare each time, without irony, that the life and death of not simply the show, but the studio and the network itself depended on fixing this episode. Which, of course, after just a few of his notes were completed, he would call again to proclaim it was now one of the greatest episodes of TV he had ever seen. And finally, pitching Peter Roth a story. My favorite person to pitch a TV show to will always be Peter Roth. If he liked what he heard, and you prayed he did, he would literally lift himself up out of the chair. There was a pact in that moment when Peter heard a great story. No one would be a bigger advocate of you or the show But in return, no one would expect more from you or your creative team. He gave his best always, and he expected the best. The best writing, the best acting, directing, production, to make audiences everywhere think and laugh and feel. Do that, and Peter Roth would practically will your show to become a hit. And man, can he make hits. In his time at Warner Brothers, Peter had 32 scripted primetime series reach the 100 episode milestone. But that's just one of the quantifiable metrics of Peter's success. The unquantifiable, of course, are the lives he changed along the way. Since Peter's a baseball fan, I'll quote the great Jackie Robinson. A life is not important except in the impact it has on other lives. Peter got to feel his impact when he announced he was leaving Warner's. The thousands of emails he received, the tribute book prepared with all the notes and cards of gratitude from all those people he had worked with through all those years. It was a fitting and Capra-esque farewell. Peter carried that scrapbook on one more car ride, this time off the Warner Brothers lot and home to his incredible family. His wife Andrea, his wonderful children Erica, Brian, Brian's wife Sarah, and his grandsons James and Tyler, also known as Pride and Joy. To all of them, I say thank you for sharing your husband, dad, and granddad with us for all these years. It's clear when you speak to Peter now, this is the most fulfilling time in his life. While dedicating most of his days to his family, he still has more meals and writes more emails of encouragement to people than anyone I know. He's begun work on the Paley Center's internship that's named in his honor, nurturing a new generation of television leaders. And according to Andrea, he's still watching cartoons, albeit this time with his more demographically appropriate grandsons. I asked Peter recently what his own parents would say if they were with us today to see their own son getting a star on the Walk of Fame. Peter said his mom would be cavilling, while his father would probably give him a quiet but deeply heartfelt, "Well done, Peter." So Peter, today, on behalf of everyone here who's been a part of your ride, and all those that cannot be here, on behalf of all the storytellers and their stories that you made better with your hard work and passion, and on behalf of the millions and millions of television fans who you helped bring so many hours of comfort and joy to for all these years, I say thank you and well done, Peter. Well done.
The Hollywood Chamber of Commerce administers the Walk of Fame on behalf of the City of Los Angeles. On behalf of Los Angeles City Council Member and President Pro Temp Mitch O'Farrell, I'd like to present you with a beautiful resolution on behalf of the city. That's what I was looking for. Now for the good stuff. It is on behalf of the Hollywood Chamber of Commerce, we now declare today Peter Roth Day in Hollywood. And now it is time to hear from our honoree. Ladies and gentlemen, Peter Roth.
Thank you. Thank you so much. My thanks first to Chuck, to Ava, to Greg, for those beautiful and extraordinarily meaningful words of support. Thank you so much. I'd also like to thank the Hollywood Chamber of Commerce, to Nicole and Anna, and to the selection committee for the Walk of Fame for this wonderful acknowledgement. You know, over the last 46 years, I've had the good fortune to be able to work with the most talented, the greatest, the most successful people working in television. Ava, Chuck, Greg are amongst the very best of that group. And as importantly, they are each dear, wonderful, generous friends. Thank you so much. So I am both humbled and deeply honored to be here today, accepting this recognition. But I do have to confess that to those outside the circle of television that don't really know me, they're going to look down on this star and say, "Who?" And they'd be right. There are so many others that have received stars in the Hollywood Walk of Fame that are far better recognized or more well known. So, to those of you who don't know me, let me introduce myself. I am that incredibly lucky soul that has spent my life working on what I love most, to work with and to be associated with some of the greatest, and yes, sometimes the worst, television series of all time. Well over 1,000 television series. I'm also the product of a lost time in our country's history, a time when the American dream was well within our grasp, as long as you had the privilege, the opportunity, as well as the determination and the will to succeed. Since that reality seems increasingly rare for so many in today's world, I intend to spend the rest of my days trying to help those that might otherwise never get that same consideration. Because the fact is that, like all of us, I am fortunate to stand on the shoulders of those that have supported me and guided me and stood by me, my mentors. They include Ira Barmack, the man who gave me my first job working in television back in January of 1975, Fred Silverman, Marcy Carsey and Tom Werner, Aaron Spelling, Stephen J. Cannell, and most recently, Bob Daley and Barry Meyer, whose honesty and authenticity and love for television would inspire even the most cynical of souls. See, Bob and Barry represent a handful of so many executives at Warner Brothers that understand and have been taught that you can be both kind and compassionate, thoughtful and generous, and still be enormously successful. Warner Brothers was my home for 22 years, and I am so thrilled that so many of my colleagues are here today, including Channing Dungey, Brett Paul, Mike Darnell, Sam Register, Clancy Collins-White, Lisa Gregorian, and Jay Levine, just to name a few. I'd also like to thank the extraordinary Jeff Tobler, whose brilliant work and effort to put together today's event has simply blown me away. Thank you so much, Jeff. Most especially, I would like to recognize the one and only Jennifer Littlehales. My true right hand and my chief of staff for my entire 22-year run at Warner Brothers. She deserves the highest praise, along with my eternal thanks, along with our great office mate, our dear friend, our colleague, the fabulous Yvonne Epps. Again, while you may not know me, you most assuredly know the real stars, those producers with whom I've been so fortunate to be associated over the years. In addition to Chuck and Ava and Greg, superstars such as J.J. Abrams, Damon Lindelof, John Wells, Mindy Kaling, Oprah Winfrey, Bill Lawrence, Jonah Nolan, the brilliant Aaron Sorkin, David E. Kelly, Amy Sherman Palladino, Bonnie and Terry Turner, Esther and Richard Shapiro, Gary Marshall, Leonard Goldberg, Bill Hanna and Joe Barbera, and the list literally goes on and on. My star has been attached to such legendary actors as Michael Douglas and Alan Arkin, Kaylee Cuoco, Jim Parsons, and the fabulous Mayim Bialik. The incomparable Kathy Bates, Allison Janney, Regina King, George Clooney, Juliana Margulies, Julie Louis-Dreyfus, Martin Sheen, Jennifer Aniston, Calista Flockhart, David Duchovny and Gillian Anderson, Henry Winkler, John Forsythe, and Linda Evans, just to name a few. Finally, and most importantly, I am and I would be nothing without my family, the greatest stars of them all. In the words of the late, great Gary Marshall, life is more important than show business. That's a truth that resonates with me more and more with each passing day. My sister Joan, my brother-in-law Bob, my nephews Jason and Aaron, my niece Lauren, their beautiful families are here with us today, and I thank God that they are. My brother Richard, his wife Jane, my nephews David and Michael and their beautiful families, my niece Samantha, some of whom are here today, all of whom I love very, very much. And then there's my own immediate family. My beautiful daughter Erica, whom I love so much, and who has enriched my life in ways I couldn't possibly imagine. My son Brian, whom I love and admire, and who's become the greatest father, husband, and man that I've ever known. His beautiful, brilliant wife, my daughter-in-law, Sarah, and my two grandsons, James and Tyler, who fill my heart with the purest, most unmitigated, most unbridled joy of my life, with one notable exception, my wife, Andrea, the greatest love I've ever known. My wife of almost 48 years, my life's partner, my soulmate, my very best friend. I love you with all my heart, Andrea. I thank God for your presence. So, my thanks to all of you for being here today and for helping to give me a day and a career and a life that has enabled me to become, alongside the great Lou Gehrig, the luckiest man on the face of the earth. Thank you, God bless you, and go Dodgers.
Now let's unveil the star. Congratulations.
Here. Yeah. And here. Anna.
Everybody to the right, please, one more time.
There we go.
And then everybody to the side. Yeah.
You good, huh?
Okay.
And here.
Thank you. Peter, let me bring Maya.
Yes. Please.
Sure. Thank you.
Right here.
Guys, right above on the second row here.
Gentlemen, all the way into the corner, please.
And one here.
Into the corner, thank you. Gentlemen,
one time, right here, last one, please. Thank you.
Bob Myers. Guys, right into the corner again, please. That's the one. Just the door. Guys, one in the corner. We're good.
Thank you. Look to your right, remember?
John, look to your left. Look to your left. Chelsea, look to your left.
Bubba's one time to the right. Here's the office.
That was the best.
Left and right arm.
That was the best that she told us.
I gotta get a shot of that.
That was the best ever. Wait till he drops it. Turn the middle. How to hold your mic, how not to hold your mic.
Interviews come up, please.
Can we get a quick photo of the star?